Good morning.
Good morning.
We find in Scripture says that, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the person who takes refuge in Him. And that video that you just saw was something that the 300 Club put together in honor of Sue Wildman. And when Gina sent it to me last night, we agreed that it'd be really nice to be able to show it to you. And taste and see that the Lord is good. 300 Club and the area tasted and see how well and how good Sue was to the area. And so that was a great little tribute there. But God invites you and I as well to experience His goodness, to provide blessings to those who may not even trust in Him. And this isn't just a call to believe in His goodness, but it is a call to engage in helping others to be able to taste and see that the Lord is good. And when we take refuge in Him, we open ourselves up to a wonderful and full experience of His goodness, leading to a life of blessing. And so, welcome, and if you're online with us, hopefully we are online. We bugged out for a little bit there. But if you're online, I want to wish you a very special welcome as well. Get some elements to take communion with us in a bit, and we're going to have a wonderful day of fellowship. But we have just a couple things going on immediately following the service. Invite you all to come out back for a hot dog roast over the open fire, as well as potluck dinner. If you didn't bring anything, that's okay. We always have plenty of food back there. It's always a wonderful time of fellowship, so stick around afterwards for lunch as we fellowship together. Wednesday is going to be elders meeting because I'm going to be gone on Thursday out to my mother-in-law's 90th birthday celebration. So that's going to be a good time. I saved some vacation days for that. Rick Oakes will be speaking for us that day. He used to be a lay preacher over at the Wilder Church back in the 90s. And then he went on from there to be the head pastor at the Grace Methodist Church that was south of YWCA back in the day on Park Avenue. And he's retired now, but he's going to graciously share some things with you and be here next Sunday to fill the pulpit for me. So I appreciate his presence there. With that said, are there any other notes or comments this morning before we continue on with our service? If not, God has a whole lot of things for you and I to continue to do while we are here on earth. And number 774 tells us that, yes, there is coming a day when we will be able to be with Him when that roll is called up yonder. I don't know about you, but I had a friend that used to say, no, I don't care whether the rapture occurs before the tribulation, during the tribulation, or after the tribulation. I'm going to be on the first wave there. So when the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. Let's stand together as we sing, shall we? Thank you. to greet some this morning in Jesus' name. God, we'd like to continue to give the Lord some praise this morning for whatever He's been doing on in your life this week. Anybody at all? Yes, Joy.
Paula is about to finish her pinpoint radiation treatment for the metastasized cancer, and she is feeling great. You're getting a little more movement in that left shoulder. So praise God for that.
Yeah, I got a text message from Jesse this last week, and she got a message from Megan's history teacher over Kent Roosevelt High School. And they have the pre-state testing test. And she got not the highest grade, but the highest grade ever gotten on that test at Kent Roosevelt High School.
Wow. Praise the Lord, that's cool.
Take that for your head off,
right? Yeah, exactly.
Yes, Jean.
Several unspoken prayers have been answered.
Thank you, Lord.
Any other praises? Yes, Dale.
Praise the Lord that we're all together again.
Yes.
Amen.
Yeah.
Who else? Yes, Brother.
I spoke to our cousin Carrie last night, and her attitude is just phenomenal. She's very positive. She's making plans for next November, 14 months out. She just has a very good attitude. So thank you everyone for praying, and continue to pray for her, because I think she starts treatment.
Well, she gets
marked this week. But so she'll be starting treatment soon. But yeah, her attitude is just awesome.
Great. Praise the Lord. Any others? That's my own prayer request then. Yes,
there was a shooting in Pennsylvania yesterday afternoon at one of the companies in Elwood, Pennsylvania, that is a customer of the people that Susan works for, that they manufacture pieces for them in their business. That's all she had to say. There was concern.
Yes, Gina.
Bill and I spoke with his sister, Velma, last night, and we spoke with her for quite a long while. We had a good conversation, but we need prayer. Her husband passed away basically, was it 3 or 4 days before Mom did, Phil? Yeah. And she's struggling a bit with depression. And then she also has an issue with her lungs. She has asthma, but they want her to do more tests. And because of the depression, she doesn't want to. So Bill and I both tried to talk her into, come on, Thelma, you need to be here with us. You need, you know, see what they can do, see what's going on. So please, Bill's sister, Thelma.
Okay. Any others? Yes, Alice.
Our friend Ed in Mansfield, who had the strokes about 3 weeks ago, he's having surgery on his carotid artery tomorrow, Tuesday. So I told his wife we would pray. I asked for prayer today.
My friend Sarah, she's having family issues, and things aren't good right now. Just prayers for her.
I'm sure there's some unspoken requests that concern family issues and a lot of other things in our lives. So the Lord knows those issues as well. Any other prayer requests? Yes, Gina.
All those traveling.
Yes. Okay. Yes, Deb.
Two gentlemen I was talking to yesterday, their names are Tim and Charlie. Please pray for them.
Right. Any others? I know someday when we see Jesus face to face. You know, all these things that we are concerned about now really won't have a whole lot of bearing when we see Him. Let's stand together. Thank Him for that day when we'll see Jesus face to face. Closer to you through all of this. We pray for Thelma, Lord, with the depression that she's still going through after her husband's passing and now the lung problems that she has. And just, Father, touch her heart and touch her mind and bring her out of this gloom and help Jean and Rhoda and Bill as well to be able to have a special ministry to them in whatever, to her in whatever way she needs to be able to have some of the things done that she needs to have done. We pray for Alice's friend that had the stroke and is having surgery coming up on his carotid artery on Tuesday. Guide the surgeons, the anesthesiologists, everybody who's part of it, that will go very smoothly. We pray for this friend Sarah with family issues and for other family issues that probably each of us know, Lord. You know the backgrounds and the dealings and the things that need to be done, even in all these unspoken requests. Touch each person that we just lifted our hands up for in Jesus' name and bring them to yourself through whether it is your leading or your conviction or whatever it may be, Father. Work in each one of their lives. And also for those who are traveling, for Imhoffs and for us and others who may be traveling this week. Lord, we thank you for your continued presence, guidance, and protection. And we'll give you the praise and the glory for the efforts all in your name. Well, how can we best describe the wondrous love of Jesus? Maybe perhaps through his grace, his mercy, the love shown to us at the cross, in light of and in the experience of his love, of his mercy, and his grace. We're going to take an opportunity as we prepare our hearts for communion to just enjoy that memory, as we allow the Gaithers to lead us to what is going to be ours someday because of the cross. Let's thank you and praise you together. Unconditionally. to forgive without limit, to serve without expecting anything in return. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross. For the joy set before you and I, we endure and we learn. And we learn how to love the same way that he loved. And Paul calls you and I to imitate this kind of maturity. That's where we're going to be today, the mature Christian. And he's not asking us to just put on a show, to try to pretend to be something that we are not. He is asking us to genuinely strive to be like Jesus, to let his character be our character, to let his values become our values, to let his priorities become our priorities. And sometimes that means allowing your own personal desires and selfishness to be broken to accomplish his greater good. Consider how much you've allowed his character to be your character, your values to be his values, and his priorities to be your priorities as we meet together. As we continue to reflect on the cross of Christ, we need to remember that it's not just what Jesus did for us, but what he asked us to do for others. It's a call to live selflessly, to love unconditionally, to serve relentlessly. It's a call to even to motivate others around us to the same kind of righteousness, to inspire others by the fact that you reflect his love through you, the same love that he demonstrated on the cross, his grace, his mercy, the mercy that he showed, that he asked you and I to show to each other, that allowed his blood to be shed so that we could be called sinless children of God. Let's thankfully drink together. Hymn 769.
Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen.
going to offer the same type of mercy, not only to others, but when we don't bring to you what you so richly deserve. Help us this week, Father, to give to you not only our offerings in the full tide, but Lord, our time, everything that we can of ourselves. Let us be our first fruits in everything we have and do, and we'll thank you for the privilege of being able to do so, knowing that you're going to take our efforts and use them for your glory, for it's in your precious name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Ago, we had the Summer Olympics in Paris, France. After a lot of dedication and hard work and preparation, athletes from all over the world came together to compete in the Olympics and for their country in Paris, France. And one pastor, I came across this article this week, a pastor that I hadn't known had a son that competed in the Olympics a while back, and here's what he says. He says, I remember how crazy 2016 was for Theron. Theron was training at a level like I had never seen from him. Everything from his diet to his mental health to his physical strength mattered. Theron competed well at the trials and he made the team and made Team USA. That year, Theron competed at the Paralympic Games in Rio de Janeiro and he came home with 2 silver medals. He says, I was so proud of him, but I can still hear him saying to me, but it wasn't gold. So after Theron competed at Rio, he continued to train at an even harder level, trained for the World Championships in Mexico City, and he was training even harder. He says he went on to make the World Championships team, and he went on to win 2 gold medals in Mexico City in the same events in which he won silver in Rio. And that's not even the most exciting and impressive part of the story, which I'm going to share with you more in just a little bit here. Charles Spurgeon, great theologian, great preacher, one time said, a good character is established is not easily overthrown. A good character, when it is established, is not easily overthrown. This is the essence of our pursuit that we've been talking about for the past 2 weeks. The character that we have that should be established in Jesus Christ, that is unshakable in the midst of the trials, in the midst of the temptations, that is unwavering, that is rooted in the firm foundation of God's truth, that is found in his precious word, the Bible. So let's turn to Philippians chapter 3 as we continue once again in our study on this book of Philippians. In chapter 2, we saw Paul talking about this race that he was running. He'd run a good race. He wanted to finish strong. Now, when you get to the end of your race, and I've asked you a few times lately, what is it that you want people to say? What kind of legacy do you hope to leave? But most importantly, as I've shared again, what do you suppose people will say about your spiritual legacy? What do you need to do to ensure a strong finish? In order to finish strong, Paul reminds us last week, you can't, you know, you're not perfect. But you can't remember that. And the older I get, the more I know that I have a long ways to go. I don't know how much longer God has for me here on this old planet, but I do know that as long as he has me here, I have a whole lot to do, as do you. And in order to have a strong finish, we need to forget the past. only not holding on to it. In 1954, there was a mile race between Roger Bannister and John Landy, the only two people in the world that had run the mile in less than 4 minutes. In the final lap, the two men were running stride for stride. The crowd was roaring, and as they came down the home stretch, Landy couldn't hear Bannister's footsteps behind him, and in a fatal lapse of concentration, he took his eyes off the finish line and looked over to see where Bannister was. Bannister took that opportunity and he finished 5 yards ahead of him. And nobody, when they hear the name John Landy, knows who John Landy is, but a lot of people remember Bannister. There were a couple of Olympic Games a month ago where we were watching the races, and the person in front looked back, and Becky can tell you, I yelped, don't do that. Are you an idiot? How long have you been training? You don't look backwards. Now, although we can learn from our past mistakes, if we hold on to them, they will just haunt us and it become very difficult to move forward if we're looking back. Try walking forward while you're looking backwards. Not going to turn out real well. Or like last week when I said, you know, try driving but only looking in the rear view mirror. And I said, you know, you almost have to have a towel around the mirror in your head because you have all the stuff going sideways and your eyes are constantly looking off the mirror. But if you had a towel around and you only looked in the rear view mirror as you're driving forward, it may not turn out real well, especially if you got a traffic coming your way. But we need to recognize that our struggles are not a sign of failure, but they're simply a sign that we are human and that we live in a fallen world. And they are a sign that we need God, that we cannot do this on our own. We need his strength. We need his guidance. We need his wisdom. And so when we are facing struggles, the first thing that we need to learn to do and to train ourselves to do is to turn to God rather than feeling, oh, I'm so sorry for myself because what I'm going through here. We need to bring our struggles to him. We need to lay them at his feet and ask him for his help. And then leave them there. Let me tell you, our struggles are not the end of the story. They are just a part of it because God has a special plan uniquely for every single one of you that is here, a plan that is better than anything any of us can ever imagine for the day when we will see Jesus. And he wants us to allow those struggles to mold us and to shape us and to give us hope. And we can have confidence in him because we have seen God work in the past and we know he's going to work in the future. I was listening to a Sirius XM message this week on the radio as I was driving along. There's a song I hear every so often that says, and I thank God for the struggles. And I remembered somebody many years ago, a gal came up to me after service and said, you know, for the first time in my life, with tears in her eyes, she said, for the first time in my life, I can thank God for my upbringing, because I know that through the things I went through, God has made me who I am today. Now, here's the amazing story about that story that I started off with just a little bit ago. He said that Theron has been retired from international swimming competition for the last several years, but he's continued to use his swimming skills. Theron, listen to this, is the first blind NCAA swim coach. And he accomplished those goals in Rio and Mexico City, but blind. Whether running a race in track or swimming, Theron and the other swim coaches will tell you, don't look back. You gotta focus on the finish, on Jesus Christ, and on heaven, rather than on the present where you find yourselves. It took Winston Churchill 3 years to get through 8th grade. because he had trouble learning Latin and he consistently finished at the bottom of his class, Sir Winston Churchill. And ironically, years later, in the midst of World War II, he was asked to speak at the Oxford University at the commencement exercises, and the popular myth is that he got up and he spoke just three words and repeated them again, never to give up, before sitting down. Well, the truth is his speech was just a little bit longer. It was more like about 20 minutes. And during that time, he said this. He said, this is a lesson that you need to learn. Never give in. Never give in. Never, 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 in nothing great or small, large or petty, never give in except to the convictions of honor and good sense. Now, unfortunately, when it comes to spiritual matters, I think we all know folks who have given in, given up, given in to sin. Some give up when the path seems to be too difficult, when trials overwhelm them. Some give up because of selfishness. Sometimes they give up because the path gets too easy. We simply forget about God. And then some give up, not necessarily external influences, but simply because they lose their faith. So let me ask you this morning, what is it that you are living for? Think about that. And ask yourself right here now, what is it that you're living for? What is your purpose in life? What are your financial goals, your occupational goals, your relationship goals, even in regards to your spouse? But most importantly, what are your spiritual goals? And then ask yourself, what are you sacrificing? What are you sacrificing that is going to hinder you from getting to those goals? And what are you sacrificing that will help you towards those goals? Same question, what are you sacrificing, but two different ideas of what you're sacrificing, that which will hinder you, that which will help you. Now, so far in chapter 3, we've seen how we deal with the past. We learn from it, and then we forget it. How do we deal with the future? We press on only with our eyes on that which will come for eternity and leave a spiritual legacy for our kids and our grandkids, which then leads us to how do we deal with the present. Let's look at verses 15 and 16 this morning of Philippians chapter 3. And Paul says, let's see, my glasses go. Hey there. Sorry. Verse 15. All of us who are mature should take such a view of things. And if on some point you think differently, that too God will make clear to you. Only let us live up to what we have already attained. Last week, we saw, not that I've already attained yet. Paul says, you know, I know that I haven't arrived yet. This race isn't over yet. I don't quite have the prize. I can't rest on my laurels. I am not yet fully the servant of God that God wants me to be. And so he says, I am not done yet growing spiritually. But now in verse 15, he says, let us as many as mature, you know, have this stuff that I've been talking about, have this mind in Christ Jesus, be looking for the goal. Now, how many of you would consider yourself as spiritually mature? He says those who are spiritually mature will agree that you're going to forget the past. You're not going to bring it up again. You're not going to let it hold you up. And we are going to press feverishly toward that heavenly goal and not doing anything that will be the wood, hay, and stubble that's going to get all burned up. But everything that we are doing in life is going to count towards that gold, silver, precious stone that I'm looking, that I'm putting aside. Now think about this. All right, still, let me ask the question again. Do you think you're spiritually mature? In this passage, Paul urges us to think like mature believers. So what's it mean to be mature in Christ? Let me tell you, it's not about age or experience. Unfortunately, if it were, a lot of us would be pretty mature by now, wouldn't we? But it is about a deep, intimate relationship with God and with Jesus, a relationship that transforms us from the inside out. It is about allowing the Holy Spirit to work within us, shaping us into the image of Christ. It is about growing in wisdom and understanding and in love. It is all about holiness, about being obedient to God's word when he says, be holy, even as I am holy. And this requires effort, requires discipline, perseverance. It requires us to constantly being willing to examine our hearts, our motives, our actions. Let me tell you something, the reward is worth it, because as we grow in maturity, we then are able to experience a deeper, a richer relationship with God. And we also be able to understand and experience a greater sense of peace, of joy, and of fulfillment. Oops. That went backwards, didn't it? There we are. Almost. It requires us to examine our hearts and our motives. But the reward is worth it. Because as we grow in maturity, we will then develop a deeper and a richer relationship with God. We experience a greater sense of his peace, of his joy, of his fulfillment. And if you don't have those experiences of his peace and his joy and his fulfillment, then you need to ask yourself, how important is it to you to be holy even as God is holy? And do you need to make some adjustments to get there? Now, mimicking maturity through Christ is not about perfection. It's about progression. It is about moving forward, step by step, day by day. It is about growing and changing and transforming and doing all that you can to understand what it means to live a holy life. It is about becoming more and more like Jesus until one day when we see him face to face with Christ my Savior, face to face, what will it be when with rapture I behold him, Jesus Christ who died for me. And when you see Jesus face to face, he'll look at you and say, man, we look like twins. Or he looks at you and he says, it looks like I'm looking in a mirror. With Jesus' sense of humor, I can just see him say, huh, it looks like I'm looking in a mirror here. Wouldn't that be great? I would love it if he would say that to me. How do we do that? We've got to spend time with him. You don't get to be a good friend with somebody without spending time with them. I'm amazed that there's several Amish young people that I've transported lately that met their spouse way down an hour or two away, Holmes County, whatnot, meeting at a family reunion or whatever. And they went down to be with them, you know, two or three times a month. And I'm thinking, man, how much did that cost you to develop that relationship? But it took time to develop that relationship until they decide, yeah, we're going to step out on here, we're going to get married. It takes time to develop that relationship with God. We need to spend time in his word, to pray, to worship, to meditate on his truths. We need to listen to his voice. Because you know something? Actions speak louder than words. We can talk all about the love of God. We can preach about the grace of God. We can sing about the mercy of God. We can say that we are mature. But unless we live it out, unless we demonstrate it through our actions to the Lord, it just remains words. Looking pretty here on Sunday mornings. And the Apostle James reminds us that faith without works is what?
Dead.
Dead. Our actions are the evidence of our faith. How much do your actions demonstrate the evidence of your faith, including the amount of time you spend with Him on a daily basis? Those are the manifestations, the outward manifestations of what your belief in the cross is all about. Now, verse 16, having dealt with the past and dealing with the future, Paul comes back to the present. Let us now live out what we've already attained. Let's live up to what I've been teaching you, what you are doing in response to what I've been teaching you. The idea seems that Paul here, having just admitted to his own imperfections, having just acknowledged that even some of them are not yet mature enough to recognize the truth that he is speaking, he says that they each need to be doing all that they can to whatever degree of spiritual maturity that they can come up to everything that they've heard about so far from Paul. In Amos 4, Amos is preaching to an Israel that had become plush with luxuries while devoid of spirituality. This is before they got sent down to Babylon, which we were studying about in Sunday school. And in the previous verse, he presents God's promise to destroy all those luxuries, the winter homes and the summer house, the houses of ivory, the great houses. And then he addresses them with this. He says, hear this word, you cows of Bashan. You who are on the mountain of Samaria. Now that's not very nice, is it? To call somebody a cow. Bashan was an ultra lush pasture land. What Amos is basically saying here is that you have become a bunch of fat cows standing around and enjoying your rich pasture land. And what he's telling us is if we have become too comfortable in our Christianity, then we are almost certainly in trouble from getting too fat. I've got that problem. At least physically. Hopefully not spiritually. C.S. Lewis once said, I didn't go to religion to make me happy. I always knew that a bottle of port would do that. If you want a religion to make you feel really comfortable, I certainly don't recommend Christianity. Because holiness, not happiness, is the chief end of man. God has called you and I to be like Him. He has called us not to be like those around us. He has called us to be like Him. And holiness is nothing less than conforming to the character of God Himself. Holiness is putting yourself in the habit of becoming one with God, of spreading His love around us, spending enough time with Him that you know what His mind is. It is the habit of agreeing with God's judgment, of hating what He hates, of loving what He loves, of measuring everything in this world by the standard of His word. Everything by God's literal word, not your own interpretation of it. You need to ask yourself, am I doing all that I can for my brothers? Am I helping them in small ways or large, encouraging them, helping them to grow in my help and in my speech? Am I showing my neighbors what godly love is all about as opposed to what they experience from the world? Am I supporting the church with all that I have, all of my time and the wealth that God has given me? Am I increasing in my knowledge of the Bible? Am I overcoming sin in my life? Big and small. Not just the little big ones. Years ago, when we used to have children's moments up here, I have a picture of me sitting down with a bunch of kids with that ivory suit I wore back then. Some of you may recall that. If I tried to wear that today, it would be about from here to here. I couldn't get anywhere near close. But there was a children's moment I gave back then where I brought them a plate of brownies. And I took a tiny piece of one and ate it. Oh man, this tastes so good. Would you want to eat flour? Yeah. Would you want to eat oil? Yeah. You want to eat raw eggs? No. How about cocoa powder? Yeah. Are you sure? Here's. And I said, you know, I put all these things in these brownies, and I just put in a very little bit of cat manure in them. And I honestly did. We had cats back then. I said, it's just a little bit. It's not going to hurt you. You still want some brownies? No! Are we getting rid of not just the big sins, but the little ones as well that have that rippling effect that we have no idea what these little sins and what we spread will do? Single-mindedness helps us to focus on the goal and to achieve it. Almost 100 years ago, there was this little black boy growing up in Cleveland. He was in a home that he later described as materially poor but spiritually rich. One day, a famous athlete, Charles Paddock, came to the school to speak to the students. At the time, Paddock was considered the fastest man in the world. He told the children, listen, what do you want to be? Think about what God can do through you, and then believe that God will do through you what he has called you to do. And the little boy decided he wanted to also be the fastest man on earth. So we went to his track coach. He told his track coach about his new dream. Coach told him, well, you know, it's fantastic to have a dream. I'm excited that you have this dream. But in this dream, any dream, you have to build a ladder to be able to get to it. And here's the ladder to your dream. The first rung is determination. The second rung is dedication. The third rung is discipline. And the fourth rung is attitude. Now, there's a whole sermon right there in that. Anybody want to stick around for another 20 minutes for me to give that sermon?
Power roast.
Oh, that's right. Power roast, that fire might go out when you do that. Well, the result of that motivation that he went on to win 4 gold medals in the 1936 Olympics. He won the 100-meter dash. He broke the Olympic and the Olympic record for the 200-meter dash. His long jump record lasted for 24 years. And this guy's name,
Jesse
1936,
Owens.
Who?
Jesse Owens.
Jesse Owens. I knew the other one. Growing into spiritual maturity is becoming less self-conscious and more God-conscious. It means loving unconditionally. Loving others without conditions, without expectations, without reservations. It means loving people just as they are. Not as you want them to be, but accepting them flaws and all, just like Jesus accepts you and I. Now, that doesn't mean that we accept sin. Please, don't misunderstand me. It doesn't mean we accept sin, but that we love the sinner. It means desiring with your whole being to live holy as God is holy. It means doing everything you can not to be a fat cow of the shadow. So let's live out this lifestyle. Let's be the hands and the feet of Jesus in this world. Let's be the light that shines in the midst of the darkness in which we find ourselves. Let's be the salt that adds flavor to light, the leaven that causes faith to rise. Let's be the voice of hope in a world that does seem to be filled with so much despair. As we decide to reach for and press with as much gumption as we can towards the goal of heaven and holiness as we get there. Let's go ahead and prayer, shall we? Father, thank you for the strength that you give. Thank you, Father, that you never leave us in the past, and help us not to allow the past to hold on to us. Father, help us to reach forward with eternity in mind in all the songs that we've been singing, Lord. It's exciting and fun to look forward to that day when we see you. But Lord, help us to be willing to put that in light of the things that we do, even presently. Help us to desire to be mature in you, Father. Whatever that means, help us to desire to live holy lives, to be holy even as you are holy, whatever that means. And we'll thank you for the joys and the peace that you are going to bring as we do so. For it's in your name we pray. This morning, as we finish up with hymn number 771, yeah, there are some things that we have to go through in this life. But you know something? It's going to be worth it when we see Jesus, and we will understand it better by and by. Let's again have the gators lead us in this wonderful song as we stand together and sing. Sing to the chorus, first off. And by when the morning comes, together we will tell the story of the golden cup, and we'll understand it better by and by. And we cannot understand all the way that God I'm gonna make you mine.
anymore.
We'll understand it better by and by. And now, may the God of peace, who brought from the dead the Lord Jesus Christ, that great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. And let us be whole as well. Amen. Let's go cook some hot dogs, shall we? And have a good time of fellowship. I can't wait to see you next week. Have a wonderful day.